Senate has approved on final reading a bill that will divide the 2nd District of Rizal into 3 separate legislative districts. For the economic implications of this move, Rizal Provincial Board Member Emigdio Tanjuatco III joins us live. Hi, Dino. Good morning. Thank you for taking our call.
Hi, good morning. Good morning, Michelle, and good morning to all your viewers.
Okay, so essentially, San Mateo is breaking away to become the 3rd district, while the municipality of Rodriguez becomes 4th district. The rest, Cardona, Badas, Tanay, Morong, Pililia, and Teresa will stay as 2nd district. Dino, I'm very curious, what are the economic implications of this separation?
To begin with, the reapportionment or the redistricting of the current 2nd district will create 2 additional districts, which is the district of the town of San Mateo and the town of Montalban. For direct economic implications, that will translate into additional 2 representatives that can, you know, that can lobby before Congress or before the House of Representatives for an additional budget for the province, which then will translate into, well, economic opportunities. We're talking about additional roads, infrastructure, which will benefit, you know, the farmers, the fisher folk. And then you have the additional budget to address the needs of the basic necessities of the Rizaleños, which are currently being addressed by the provincial government. However, the additional representatives or the additional representation before the House of Representatives for additional funding will definitely redound to the benefit of the whole province. So there's a relation between the additional districts and the economic upturn or upside of the province.
Could you give us a sense of the business environment in Rizal? I know that tourism is big. For the longest time, though, Rizal has also been pushing the IT BPO industry. Are you benefiting from a recent resurgence in BPO investments and transactions?
Yes. Well, prior to the onset of the pandemic, Rizal was one of the leading provinces in terms of the BPO industry, especially in the first district of the province and the city of Antipolo, which, because of its proximity to Metro Manila, take advantage of the influx of employees for that industry. However, with the reapportionment of the additional districts, like you mentioned, the 7 towns, they're more of agricultural in nature. So you have the fisher folk, the farmers, the those that still rely on garden industries, rice, corn, tree planting, and then San Mateo and Montalban, because of their proximity to, let's say, the more urban areas like Marikina, we'll also benefit if you go back to industries such as the BPO industry and other more urbanized businesses.
For the 7 towns, Dino, that will be left with the 2nd district, what are the risks that they will be left behind? Because you did mention the 7 towns left with the 2nd district are those that are dependent on agriculture.
Yes, yes. I don't see any, large scale or risks of great magnitude. Geographically, the current 2nd district, the 7 towns are more or less segregated from the towns of San Mateo and Montalban. So in terms of self-reliance and resiliency, because of their agriculture nature, the 7 towns, they're more or less they're self-sufficient. And that's why the reapportionment or redistricting will give the representative more focus on, let's say, on the 7 towns, as compared to what is happening presently, when The current representative has to deal with 9 towns, and 2 of those towns are San Mateo and Montalban, which are more urbanized than agriculture and agricultural. So with the reapportionment, the representatives have now a more focused approach to their constituency. The congressman will not have to, have to travel, far distances to be able to address the needs of the constituents.
I know that Rizal is also pushing for PCIP, or the provincial commodity investment plans, for banana, mango, and pineapple growers, or those within the agri supply chain. How is your agri coping today?
Well, again, we'll have to attribute the lackadaisical behavior of commodities because of the current situation. However, before, I guess indication would be that the province, for the, if I'm not mistaken, for the 5th consecutive year, was given the most competitive province award. So I guess in terms of commodities and products within the province, you can see that we were doing pretty well. And again, I go back to the whole reapportionment event, that it will definitely enhance the products and the commodities in the province.
Very quickly, Dino, do you get a sense that everybody's for this reapportionment? Or are there some sides who say maybe not?
To begin with, the reapportionment or redistricting, the matter of redistricting or reapportionment is a legislative function of the legislative branch.
But how do the locals feel?
I guess there are some, that still, are still, maybe they're still trying to absorb the event, considering that the focus really now of the provincial government is to address what's happening because of the pandemic and the needs of the people. So as far as the provincial government is concerned, that's what we're doing. We, however, defer to the to the wisdom of the legislative branch of government, more in this case the Senate, which we thank for having that foresight for the province. I guess in the long run, that are ambivalent or maybe indifferent to what had just happened, we'll be able to feel the effect. But right now, I go back to the provincial government is still focusing on addressing the pandemic-related needs of the Rizalenos. At the same time, we have high regard for the Senate for thinking of the province and having that foresight looking at the future.
We don't have much time. Just two quick questions. Number one, how is your province ready for a COVID-19 vaccine rollout? Do you have the facilities in place, the training already in place for when the vaccine comes?
Yes. On the part of the provincial government, we have already allotted a budget for the purchase of the vaccines when they arrive, and for facilities. I know the city of Antipolo has been preparing cold storage facilities. In preparation, because we don't want to be left behind when the vaccines arrive. We don't want to be scampering. So right now the focus is really on addressing the procurement of the vaccines when they arrive.
And procuring, sir? How many vaccines?
I don't have the exact figures, but what I'm sure is that the province will be able to provide for, because I know the different municipalities and the city of Antipolo have their own procurement contingencies in place. So the province will also procure and make sure that those less developed areas, the far-reached areas, will be able to have access to.
Okay. Okay, on that note, thank you very much for joining us, Dino, this morning.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Michelle, for the opportunity.
Thank you.